Hey guys, it's Ren. Today we're going to be playing the demo for a Otome visual novel game called Hocus Pocus Prince. I believe it will be Kickstartered in the future, so keep an eye out for that. The demo is set your own price, so you can get it free or you can donate to the developers if you feel like it. But you should definitely go and get it and play it yourself, because it looks so cute! And I'm really excited to show it to you. So let's get started. What is my name? I don't know, something silly. Cat butt. Yeah, confirm. Hocus Pocus Prince, prologue. Okay. Oh my.
Spirits of shadows, hear my spell. I summon you in my direst hour. Come forth, demons of darkness. Come forth and answer my call.
I draw the final side of the pentagram on the floor. Then, hands shaking, I start placing candles all over the five corners.
Become my eyes so I can see into the blackest nights.
The first candle wobbles when I set it down. Gulping, I do my best to steady it. Oh, don't knock it down, dear.
Become my ears so I can hear the whispers of ghosts.
My hands are so slippery with sweat that I almost drop the second candle. Wow, you make good life decisions.
I can't mess up again. I've already tried so many times. But become my voice, so I might...
As I grab the third candle, I sneak a glance at my notes. So I might command armies of undead to, smite my friends. I mean foes! Please smite my foes, not my friends. Yeah, that'd be bad.
Oh, Lucifer, what are you doing? Don't step into the cursed circle.
As always, Lucifer ignores me, as I'm sure Lucifers are wont to do. He just strolls into the middle of the pentagram and plops down for a nap. When I try and pick him up, he shoots me a look of withering disdain.
Sorry.
What else can I say? Even though he's just a fat black cat, his glare would put a real demon to shame.
At least I almost made it to the third candle. That's almost halfway.
Wow, you too.
Yeah, I know. I've been saying almost all day long.
How long have you been at this?
What am I going to do, Lucifer? At this rate, it'll take me a whole week to master the shadow summoning ceremony. And I only have tonight.
Meow.
If only your old master were still here, Layla would have nailed this no problem. Now that it's just me, I just don't want to disappoint her. If I don't get better soon, if I mess up tomorrow in front of all those people, I don't know what I'm going to tell her.
Not so loud now, are you?
Lucifer?
Looking down, I see he's already stretched out and fallen asleep.
Oh well.
Not wanting to disturb him, I pick up the candles. Maybe I can draw another pentagram under my desk and start over. Chalk in hand, I crawl under my desk and repeat the incantation.
Spirits of shadows, hear my spell. I summon you in...
Cadbutt, what are you doing under there?
I don't know what I just tried to do.
Oh, jeez, God, good God.
Well? My head hits the desk when I bolt up. I grimace, half from the pain shooting through my skull and half from the light flicking on. When I crawl out, my mom is standing next to me. She glances at my pentagram, then at the messy pile of black robes, tarot cards, and plastic skulls on the floor. My already shaky confidence shrivels up under her stare.
I was just, doing something for school?
Uh-huh, let me guess. You were trying to summon Satan again, or speak to the dead. Else you're making another deal with the devil to get out of doing your homework.
I haven't tried that since third grade. That last one, at least.
Mom doesn't even blink.
She's been an ER doctor for 15 years, and I've yet to see anything faze her.
It really is for school, Mom. I'm practicing my presentation for the club fair tomorrow.
I point at the display I've been slaving over all week. There's a trifold poster plastered with pictures of demons and ghosts next to a stack of flyers with the tagline, "Dare to be scared." I've even decorated a plate of cake pops to look like eyeballs and made zombie brain cupcakes dripping with cherry sauce blood.
All the school clubs will have their own booth to advertise at the club fair. I have to make a good impression to the new students while I'm there so that they'll join the occult club.
Good impression, right. That definitely explains the demon summoning. She's got a point.
Oh, don't worry, that's just pretend. Layla and I wanted to act out a cool ritual as a publicity stunt. But now that she's studying abroad, well, it's harder with just me. Especially since I'm the worst public speaker in the entire school.
Mom eyes my club sign-up sheet, fucking hell, which is hanging from a clip shaped like a severed hand. Not that I'm surprised, but wow, the public school system has really gotten lax. I still can't believe they let you and your crazy friend start an occult club, and that they still haven't shut it down now that you're the only member. Still, it beats all the hobbies I had as a kid, namely sleeping, eating, and sleeping after eating. So if you can keep your club going, you have my respect.
Yeah.
If I can keep it going. Right. Though I've been a fan of horror and the supernatural even as a kid, it's not the easiest hobby to share with others. I learned that the hard way. Ever since I brought my Dante's Inferno diorama to show and tell, and wore an overly realistic ghost girl Samako, that's a Sadako reference, costume for Halloween, my classmates have called me a creepy weirdo. Some even thought I was a witch. So when I started high school last year, I kept my head down. Tried my hardest to fit in. Maybe even make a friend or two, as hard as that seemed. For me, talking to new people is much scarier than any horror movie. When my classmate Layla caught me practicing with tarot cards, I didn't know what to do. I was so scared of what she'd say that she might as well have been Satan sentencing me to eternal damnation. But Layla didn't freak out or make fun of me. She just said I was reading the cards wrong and spent the better part of an hour teaching me how to do it right. We've been best friends ever since.
If it weren't for Layla, I never would have had the confidence to start the occult club. Even now, I'm really glad that she pushed me on. My memories from that club are some of my best, even though we were the only members. But now that Layla's studying abroad, I'm all alone again. If I don't get more members for the occult club this year, there might as well not be an occult club at all.
Mom clears her throat. Speaking of your crazy friend, this came in the mail today. Should I call the bomb squad in advance this time? Oh, has there been a history of that?
Mom hands me a beat-up package covered in dirt stains. My face lights up when I see who it's from. Layla! Don't worry, Mom. She probably just sent me some fun souvenirs.
Knowing that girl's idea of fun doesn't reassure me.
What do you mean?
Never mind. That's the face of judgment. You can go back to your weirdo demon summoning now. Just tell Satan not to take your soul until you do the dishes. Wow.
Once Mom leaves, I tear open the package. Out falls a letter and photograph, wrapped in a whole roll's worth of wrinkled toilet paper. Why toilet paper? Why indeed? Knowing Layla, though, I guess I'm not that surprised.
Why?
I look at the photo first. In it, Layla is posing in front of a beautiful castle. She's cheerfully making her trademark peace sign, and as usual, getting a lot of funny looks from the people in the background. Smiling, I pick up the letter.
Yo, cat butt, check it out! My new school looks just like Sleeping Beauty's palace, or some fairy tale crap like that. I could totally be a princess right now, or maybe the evil witch. Yeah, I totally rock a black dress better.
Oh, look at this sweet little Hot Topic child. I love it.
but yeah! Living it up in a new country has been hella cool. I still suck balls at the language, though. Apparently the word for banana sounds like the word for bowels, and enchilada sounds like entrails! Talk about weird misunderstandings! I kept asking my host family where to get fresh intestines, and they just took me out to lunch. How the heck am I gonna brew my special stew now? Anyway, thanks again for taking care of Luce while I'm gone. He's a pain in the butt to clean up after, so don't let him run around too much, okay?
I glance at Lucifer, who's still asleep on the floor. Imagining such a lazy cat running anywhere makes me giggle.
I know Club Fair's coming up, so sorry times infinity I'm not there to help lure noobs into our cult. You go knock 'em dead, cat butt. You always work your butt off, so I'm not even gonna wish you luck. I'm 1024% positive that you'll make the occult club the best club ever. Ha ha. Just kidding. You already have. Slugs and kisses, Layla. P.S. Recruit as many hot guys as you can. We could use more eye candy.
P.P.S.
I like long-haired guys the best.
P.P.P.S.
Short hair is okay too, but ew, please no buzz cuts. Okay, I'm done.
La-la out! That's a typo, I think. P.P.P.P.S.
This is the last one, I promise! I completely forgot until I went to send the package just now, but I got you a present from abroad.
I hope she isn't talking about the toilet paper.
Don't worry, your present isn't the toilet paper. It's what's inside the toilet paper. As soon as I saw it, I knew I had to send it to you. I've never seen any other talisman that's so full of magical energy!
A magical talisman? Oh, maybe it's a sorcerer's grimoire, or a cursed dagger, or even the haunted ashes of an evil spirit. I unwrap the toilet paper as fast as I can, but when I tear off the last piece, my excitement turns into confusion. All I see is a necklace with a small blue stone. It's less haunted ashes and more trinket you'd find at the dollar store. Oh, sweetheart, but those are always the most haunted ones! Now I feel silly for getting my hopes up so high.
It's a lovely souvenir for sure, and it was sweet of Layla to get it for me. But is it really magical? It doesn't seem out of the ordinary.
Maybe Layla was just imagining all that so-called magical energy. Truth be told, I think she can sometimes be kind of quirky. As I hold the necklace up to the light, something rushes behind me. Rustles.
Huh?
You too. Turning around, I see Lucifer crouched below my arm. His body is pressed low and tense as if he's about to pounce.
Oh, Lucifer, you startled me. Did you have a nice nap?
When I try to pat his head, he ducks out of reach.
So what do you think? Is this necklace magical?
Lucifer's eyes follow the pendant as it swings back and forth. A low hiss forms in his throat.
Lucifer?
Yowling like I've set his tail on fire. Lucifer lunges at my hand. I quickly yank it back.
Hey, stop!
Of course Lucifer doesn't listen to me. He just leaps into the air and shoots straight past me. Right into the pile of toilet paper that I've left on the floor.
Meow. Lucifer, no!
I watch helplessly as he attacks the toilet paper with his claws. In no time at all, the floor is covered in white fluff. Have fun cleaning that up.
P-P-P-P-S! Oh, by the way, all the toilet paper's for Luce. He loves or hates it even more than catnip. You probably shouldn't let him play with it inside, though.
I wish that warning had been at the beginning instead of at the end. As Lucifer continues his rampage, I re-examine the necklace. As cool as it would be to see real magic, I don't know if I should get my hopes up again. I've had way too many disappointments in the past for that.
I don't know about this whole magical talisman thing, Layla. Even if things like that exist, you'd have to be super lucky to ever get one. My life, at least, has never been that lucky.
Even so, I fasten the pendant around my neck and tuck it safely under my shirt. Whether it's magical or not, I know that Layla's doing her best to wish me well, and that's all the luck I need. Feeling more determined already, I clear away the toilet paper and start sketching another pentagram. If Layla's counting on me, I absolutely can't let her down.
Don't worry, Layla. I'll practice all night if I have to, until I get things right.
12 hours later, I'm beginning to regret getting so fired up. Pulling an all-nighter has left my body weak and shaky. Now I can barely keep my eyes open, much less lug my stuff to the school gym for the club fair.
I underestimated how heavy all these props and food are. I should have made more trips, instead of trying to carry everything at once.
As I turn the corner, I slip and stumble. The stack of boxes in my arms teeters dangerously forward.
Ah! No, no! Please, stay up!
I shove the boxes against a door to keep them from toppling over. One girl gives me a strange look as I press myself against the wall, panting.
Hey, do you?
Yes?
Mind getting out of the way? You're blocking the door.
I'm sorry.
Trying to ignore the pain stabbing through my arms, I keep walking. Maybe I should have asked for help, but I don't know many other students that well, and she looked angry. Feeling pretty pathetic, but even more exhausted, I put on a burst of speed for the home stretch.
It's okay, I've almost made it to the gym. Just a few more steps, and I should be good too.
Ugh. Oh, he looks so uncomfortable. Oh, you poor baby. I stop when I spot two people down the hallway. One of them is a girl from my class, and she is blushing like crazy in front of a boy with brightly dyed hair. Oh, thank God it's dyed. It's like a scene from an old-fashioned romance novel or shoujo. The last scene I'd want to barge into with all my big, heavy, badly balanced boxes.
This hallway is the fastest path to the gym, but it'd be awkward to interrupt them now.
Not sure what else to do, I back up around a corner and set my boxes down. As much as I dislike the idea of sticking around, I like the idea of lugging my stuff back even less.
I'll just wait for them to finish. It can't take that long, right?
Famous last words.
It all started when we were both late for the first day of school. We crashed into each other in the hall.
10 minutes later.
And after I saw you, sir, a winning goal in that soccer tournament, I promised them what I was cheering for.
Maybe I should prepare my costume while I'm waiting. Now where did I put my demon summoning staff and hooded cape? 20 minutes later.
And it turned out to be the cherry blossom from my childhood was the first place we were really met.
Oh, and here's my old zombie mask, too. Though I made it for Halloween several years ago. It might not fit anymore. Let's just try it on for size. Half an hour later.
And that's why it's our destiny to be together no matter what.
This mask is still pretty comfortable. Maybe I should wear it after... Oh, it got quiet all of a sudden. Did they leave? Just as I'm about to peek around the corner, the boy speaks up.
Wow, I don't know what to say, but I'm really happy that you care about me so much. Thank you for being honest about your feelings.
Then, does that mean that you accept that?
Well, to be honest, I don't think that's a good idea.
He turned her down? Oh no. Feeling guilty for overhearing something so sensitive, I start packing up my boxes. Maybe I should take another route to the gym after all.
What?
I guess I'm not a very romantic guy. But I don't believe in destiny or strings of fate or love at first sight. So, even when you say all those things, all I think is that we haven't really talked before.
I was admiring you from afar!
I think you know a lot about me, but I still don't know very much about you, and that's not very fair to either of us. I'm really sorry. Hey, come here, it'll be alright. Because what I know so far is you're a brave, honest person. And I think people like that are pretty cool. I also think you look better when you're smiling.
Really?
Really, really, please, please, please don't cry anymore. Sorry. I'm kind of a big dork when I don't know what to do.
He breaks off as the girl throws her arms around him and starts sobbing into his shirt. For the next few minutes, he gently pats her on the head and murmurs encouraging words into her ear. He is far nicer than I would be. He is so patient. I am amazed. My chest grows tight in sympathy. Even though I've never made a love confession before, I know what it's like to be rejected. After the girl calms down, she gives the boy a genuinely grateful smile.
Thanks, Vincent. You really are the nicest guy in the whole school.
She kisses his cheek and heads off with a skip in her step. I slowly release the breath I was holding.
I'm glad everything turned out all right.
Aw, he's got a little tiny blush.
The boy, Vincent, manages a small smile of his own. Then he turns around with a much sterner expression.
You can come out now.
Huh? He knew I was here all along?
I freeze up in panic. But before I can blurt out an apology, a group of upperclassmen pops out further along down the hall. Snickering, they flock over to Vincent, filling up the entire corridor.
Yum! It's Vincent Asher! The nicest, cutest, most popularest guy in the whole school! Oh my gosh, Vinny, please marry me now!
Seriously, dude, what is this, your fourth declaration of undying love this term? At school only started last week!
I thought that the story about the cherry blossom tree was really touching.
Didn't I tell you guys to stop eavesdropping on me? Don't you remember what happened the last time you got caught?
Hey, how were we supposed to know that the one chick was in the karate club?
My bruises still haven't faded.
Besides, we weren't eavesdropping this time, at least not intentionally. We've been looking all over for you. You were supposed to come to the club fair and help me set up the soccer team's table.
Fuck.
30 minutes ago, all our teammates were asking what happened.
You promised to man the student council booth later, too. The press said she wanted you up front, remember?
Soccer and student council can wait. The competitive eating club's hot dog extravaganza starts in 10 minutes, and our team needs you ASAP!
Just how many clubs is this guy in?
Vincent sheepishly rubs the back of his head.
I'm sorry for the trouble, you guys. I should have left a lot sooner, but, well, I felt kind of bad about blowing her off.
Why not? You get every love confession as it is! Can't you just blow off one? How about your friends? The girl wasn't even that hot this time!
How dare you make judgments like that? I'm sure you're not all that either.
Yeah, her eyes were way too big for her head!
Are you aware of your own genre? Well, most girls nowadays are kind of like that. Vincent breaks in with a laugh as his friends start to squabble.
I don't know. I guess I don't really notice looks. I mostly just like people who are fun to hang out with.
What a goody-goody guy! It's not like her personality's any better. You do know she's been stalking you since last year, right?
And she built a shrine with every can of soda you've ever thrown away.
And it's held together with every piece of gum you've ever chewed.
Wow, you have to admire that much dedication.
What an annoying guy!
Seriously, Vince, if you're okay with all that, why'd you turn her down?
Well, like I said, I really don't know her that well.
Pausing, Vincent runs a hand through his turquoise hair.
And, well, I noticed that she stopped following me whenever I was watching horror movies. And if I'm dating someone, I'd want them to go see the final destination with me.
What a petty guy! You guys were the ones who were talking about how she's not hot enough for you, and you want to call him petty?
Huh? Though I've zoned out until now, hearing the name of a familiar movie series piques my interest.
Vince, come on! You're never gonna find another girl who likes those trashy slasher fics! Or any other guy, for that matter! I
don't think that's true.
What? The Final Destination series isn't trash. Yes, the plots are silly and the reviews are usually bad, even for horror movies. But that's because most film critics don't appreciate the innovative costume design and special effects.
Hey, don't diss Final Destination. The SFX are some of the best in the industry.
Exactly! Wait, what did he just say?
The mass exorcism scene in Final Destination 14 was a legit masterpiece. Even especially since they didn't use CGI. Though the original Socio movie was still the best when it comes to creative blood splatter.
Ew!
Ooh.
And man, that part where they all made all the ghosts' heads spin around and scream in an homage to...
He stops when he realizes his friends are slowly backing away.
Sorry, guys. Looks like I got carried away again.
Some friends you have, jeez.
I mean, I know I've got a weird hobby, and most people don't get why I like it. It's just, it'd be nice to find someone I don't have to hide that from. Someone who likes horror too. Or at the very least, someone who won't think I'm a serial killer when I start nerding out about it. Or is that still too much to hope for? Yes!
I can't believe it. He likes the same films I do, and he's been feeling left out as I have. I never thought I'd find someone like that. Could he be the one I've been searching for all this time?
The perfect person for my club. Not a boyfriend or anything, just for the club, yeah. I hug a stack of flyers to my chest. Even if he's already in a billion other clubs, I have to tell him about a cult club. Word of advice, Vince, keep your freaky ghost fetish under wraps or you won't be getting any more confessions ever. Why do you like freaky ghost movies so much anyway?
Actually, Final Destination will be a zombie movie. And man, is it gonna be epic! They're gonna revive all the characters who were killed in the previous movies and bring them back as an undead army to...
His friends just stare blankly because they don't care about his emotional well-being in the least.
Never mind, I'll be normal now.
You know, I don't even get the point of zombies. Like, won't a dead body fall apart as soon as it starts walking?
Yeah, that's not realistic at all. How can anyone be scared of something so dumb?
I guess you're right. Anyway, we should probably get to the club fair, huh?
As the boys start to leave, I finally work up the courage to rush after them. In my hurry, I forgot that I was still wearing the black robes for my costume. My foot catches on the long hem, making me trip.
Ah!
I forgot I was still wearing my zombie mask, too. Ah, a real zombie!
It must have heard us calling it dumb.
Eat me last, I have the smallest brain!
The boys take off running down the corridor, screaming all the way. I almost scream too as I plunge forward. Just before my face meets the floor, someone catches me mid-fall. Wow, so romantic!
Huh?
Are you okay?
My heart skips a beat when I see Vincent Asher gazing down on me. For a second, all I can think about is what a bright, clear shade of purple his eyes are. And how close his face is to mine! As Vincent keeps looking at me, his cheeks grow hot behind my cheeks grow hot behind my mask. Though I want to move away, my body seems frozen in place.
That was a close call. You're not hurt, are you?
I shake my head. The only thing I've hurt is my self-dignity. Tripping like that was way too clumsy. This is so embarrassing. Vincent frowns in worry when I don't speak up. Maybe he's mistaken my embarrassment for a sign of pain or distress.
Can you stand up on your own? If you want, I can walk you to the nurse's office.
I quickly shake my head again. Even though we're just strangers, he seems really concerned about me. Vincent's left arm wraps around my shoulders, trying to better support my body. That's when I realized I'm still clinging onto his right arm. Very, very tightly. I jump away before I can stop myself, and then awkwardly creep back. At least with my mask on, he can't see how red my face is.
You had some killer timing popping out when you did. Thanks for that, man. I love my friends and all, but it sucks when they start ragging on my favorite movies. You're a zombie fan too, right? Judging by that awesome costume, at least.
Awesome costume? Really?
I point hesitantly at my homemade mask and robes. Vincent's smile grows into an all-out grin.
The undead necromancer from The Stalking Dead Season 2, am I right?
He knows which TV show I base my costume on.
A warm bit of happiness wells up in my heart. It's all I can do to nod in gratitude.
I absolutely have to ask him to join the occult club. But can I ask right away, or is that too forward? Oh, I should probably introduce myself before that. Or should I thank him for catching me first? I've never been any good with words, especially when talking to strangers. There's a long silence as I struggle with what to say. Vincent, however, just flashes me a thumbs-up sign.
Oh, right. Zombies can't talk. Kudos for being so committed to your role.
At a loss for what else to do, I just nod along. Maybe it's best if I let him do the talking.
So where have you been all my life, zombie bro, and why haven't we met before? You a new student?
I hesitate and then nod again. It's easier than admitting that I was just really bad at socializing last year.
Nice to meet you. I'm Vincent Asher. I'm a third year, even though I probably don't look or act my age. Feel free to ask anything about my classes, cafeteria food, or the meaning of life.
He lowers his voice to a playful whisper.
Psst, it's 42, and I recommend the pizza.
Hello, middle school.
Oh, and also let me know if you need any help choosing a club. We've got a lot of awesome ones at this school.
Before I lose my nerve, I shove my club flyers at him. Vincent blinks in surprise and then reads the printouts.
Do you like horror and the paranormal? Do you dare to be scared? Join the occult club today. Does that mean you've already joined the occult club?
I nod and then point emphatically at the line that says, "Join the occult club today!"
Do you want me to join the occult club too?
I nod again. Looking torn, Vincent scratches the back of his head.
It does sound pretty fun. If your meetings aren't at the same time as soccer practice or student council meetings or whatever, maybe I could stop by.
I nod so hard that my mask almost falls off. Honestly, he could have asked for my firstborn child and I'd probably still agree.
Actually, there's still one problem.
Huh? But why?
It's dumb, though. You don't want to know.
What? Of course I do! You can't just leave me hanging!
I'm already dressed as a monster, so I might as well go all out! Crossing my arms, I trap him in my creepiest evil zombie stare.
Yeah, I know. That was a pretty dumb excuse.
Hard stare.
Come on, don't make me say it.
Demonic stare!
Please, stop glaring at me!
Ultimate death stare of doom and destruction!
It's just that... Well, promise you won't tell anyone. Absolutely cross your heart and hope to die promise.
My neck is starting to get sore from all this nodding.
Just between you and me, I know a certain person in the occult club.
I freeze up in mid-nod. That was not the answer I was expecting.
You've probably met her already. She's one of the girls who started at the club last year.
Oh, he must be talking about Layla. She is pretty fun to hang out with, like he was saying.
Her name is Cat Butt Cross.
Huh? He's talking about me?
I don't know if she knows who I am, but I just can't forget about her.
He can't forget about me?
Woo! But then does that mean... Time seems to freeze as Vincent looks down at me. As I thought before, his eyes are strikingly bright. So bright that I can't seem to look away.
Does that mean he doesn't think I'm too shy and weird and creepy? Does that mean he thinks I'm... fun?
As Vincent leans in to whisper, my cheeks grow warm. My heart starts pounding so loudly, I almost don't hear what he says next.
Don't tell this to anyone, all right?
Is this really happening? It's all so... so...
The truth is, I just can't stand Cat Butt Cross. I don't want to be in that club if she's there too.
What? What? The fuck have I ever done to you? I don't even talk to anyone. Why would anyone hate this precious baby who doesn't even, like, do anything?
Unexpected?
Don't tell anyone else, okay? Especially not her.
Funny story.
Anyway, my friends probably think you've eaten my brains by now. I should probably head over to the club fair. Before that, do you need a hand with your stuff? Here.
When Vincent reaches for my boxes, I finally pull myself together. Before he can pick them up, I grab all of them myself. The heavy stack wobbles in my arms, but I grit my teeth and press on. I should have known it was too good to be true. I should have known better than to get my hopes up. Real life. My life. Is never that lucky.
Aw, she just wants a friend!
Vincent's look of concern makes me feel even worse. I don't want him looking at me like that. I don't want him looking at me at all. I just want to escape as fast as I can. Preferably into a bottomless pit. Or under the heaviest possible rock. Vincent calls out as I hurry down the hall.
Hey, wait a second. I didn't catch your name.
Right. Zombies can't talk.
Well, zombie bro, guess I'll catch you later.
I manage a small wave goodbye, but my heart isn't into it. My head is too full of two revelations I still can't believe. Vincent Asher, super popular third year, actually knows who I am. Vincent Asher, fellow horror fan and the so-called nicest guy in school, hates my guts.
But why?
As soon as I reach the club fair, I hide my costume at the bottom of my biggest box. The last thing I want is for Vincent to find out that his zombie bro is me in disguise. Vincent himself is right across the gym, joking with his friends. Every time I glance over, students from other clubs are chatting with him or asking for help with their displays. In just a few minutes, Vincent is carrying boxes for the cheerleading squad, setting up tournament tables for the chess team, even assembling part of a giant robot for the Fuck Yeah Science Club.
Vincent seems to get along with everybody else. So why can't he get along with me? We've never even spoken to each other.
Was there something bad about the way I dressed or cut my hair? How much I stuttered when I ordered food in the lunch line? How I sometimes ate in the bathroom when I couldn't find Layla in the cafeteria? Or maybe even those middle school rumors of...
You know what I bet it is? I bet that he had like a giant crush on us when we were like 5 or something, and we broke his heart.
That's my guess. We'll see. I don't know if we're going to find out in the demo. I don't know if we're going to go quite deep enough into the story. But that is my theory. The more I obsess over it, the more insecure and self-conscious I feel. Am I so bad that even the so-called nicest guy in school can't stand me? That is a pretty crushing thought. I would be depressed too. That's really not nice at all. What the hell did we do? The truth is, there are a lot of things that even the nicest person ever could dislike about me. And what if Vincent isn't the only one who feels that way? What if the reason no one else will join the occult club is because they don't want to be around me? Even though I started a cult club in the first place, would it actually be better off without me? Ah! Good job. A loud crash jerks me back to reality. I've been so busy wallowing in self-pity that I've dropped a box of props. Falling to my knees, I start picking up scattered skulls. Snap out of it, Catbutt. Even if recruiting Vincent is a lost cause, I can still find other people. I just have to pull myself together and work even harder. Resolving to do better, I turn all my attention to the occult club booth. After 15 minutes of focused work, I'm putting the finishing touches on my display. I place the sign-up sheet smack dab in the front, surrounded by the eyeball cake pops and brain cupcakes. Hopefully the sweets will draw in potential members. Loud voices signal an incoming crowd of students. Trying not to fidget, and failing miserably, I stand in front of my booth to wait. And wait. And wait some more.
Nobody's coming to my booth. Not even for the food.
I guess I shouldn't be so surprised. All the other clubs are yelling for new students to come over, or shoving flyers at everyone they see. To compete for attention, I need to be more aggressive.
gulping, I creeped forward with a stack of my homemade brochures.
If you have time, please come see the Occult Club. It's, really fun. I think you'll like it a lot. At least I hope you do.
I can't even hear myself over all the yelling people, and my nervous attitude isn't doing me any favors. Taking a deep breath, I try again.
Please come to the Occult Club. We, have free food. Come to the Occult Club. We really, really need new members. Occult Club over here, Occult Club.
Even at full volume, my voice is still lost in the sea of shouting people. I need another approach.
If I go up to students directly, I might be able to lead them over here.
But just the thought of approaching strangers makes my stomach twist.
Be brave for once, Catbutt. The worst they can say is no, right?
Even so, my palms are already damp with sweat. Trying to build up courage, I focus on two nearby students.
I'll ask them first. It's no big deal. I'll just walk up, hand them some flyers, and say...
I must have focused too hard, though, because one student starts whispering to her friend.
Why is that weird girl staring at us? I don't know, but it's creeping me out.
What little confidence I have goes out like a flame under a fire hose.
Maybe I should do my shadow summoning ceremony instead. That should definitely attract attention.
Though I wanted to save it for the end. Desperate times call for desperate measures. Hands shaking, I start sketching a pentagram.
Spirits of shadows, hear my spell. I summon you in my direst hour.
My fingers tighten around the chalk as I struggle to steady my voice.
Come forth, demons of darkness. Come forth and answer my call.
That's better. Concentrating on the words to my spell, which I've practiced more times than I can remember, I start placing candles.
Become my eyes, so I can see into the blackest nights. Become my ears, so I can hear the whispers of ghosts.
As I set down the second candle, I feel a small urge of relief.
So far, so good. I didn't screw up anything yet.
I sneak a glance at two students. They're definitely looking at me now, even if their mouths are wide open in horror.
Is she really trying to summon a demon? That is too weird. Let's go back to the Lolcats Club. I need some cute kitty pictures, stat.
They scramble off, but at least more heads are turning in my direction. Feeling anxious but encouraged by the extra attention, I continue the ritual.
Become my voice so I might command armies of undead to smite my foes!
My voice rings out more loudly than I expect. At first, I wonder if I really have become more confident. It takes me a second to realize that the gym has just gotten much quieter. Ooh, who's this? As a tall, imposing figure steps through the doors, the crowd falls back, like the Red Sea parting before Moses. Skin as pale as an alabaster statue, hair as dark as a raven's wing. Though I'm not usually given to such poetic turns of phrases, they fit this guy to a T. With his aloof attitude and smoldering good looks, Orion Seth looks like he just waltzed right out of a Victorian Gothic novel. Either as the dashing young hero or the vampire haunting his castle. Gee, I wonder if that was a hint to things. Layla and I had a few classes with Orion last year. It didn't take long for us, or anyone else, to notice him.
That Orion dude is super pale and super duper mysterious, Layla told me. Yeah, he's top of the class and hella hot in a broody Lord Byron way, but he talks to even fewer people than you do, Catbutt. No offense, of course. I bet he's hiding a deep, dark secret. Maybe even a tragically bloody backstory. You know what all that means, right?
I bet it's the opposite. I bet he's, like, into comedy or something. When I suggested we break out the garlic, Layla flashed me her biggest grin. The one she saves for her biggest, craziest ideas.
If this guy is a modern-day Dracula, preferably the non-sparkly kind, we absolutely have to get him into a cult club.
Orion, however, wanted nothing to do with us, or any other clubs. Everyone from the basketball team to the drama club tried and failed to recruit him. No matter who was asking, Orion's answer was always the same. A cold, curt no. Even when we were in the same classes, I never heard him say anything besides no over and over again. Well, that's not completely true. One time, our English teacher paired us up for a Shakespeare skit project. I don't think I've ever gotten more glares from the other girls, as well as some of the guys. I wasn't too thrilled either. Top student or not, Orion disappeared most of the time when I was working, so I had to make all of the props and costumes myself. The day before we were supposed to present, I was sweating bullets, convinced I'd have to get in front of the class and mumble through the entire skit alone. But just before our turn, Orion finally showed up and proceeded to blow everyone away with an award-worthy performance of the gravedigger's scene from Hamlet. I still get chills thinking about him standing there, skull in hand and fire in his eyes. Even me stammering through Horatio's lines didn't keep us from getting a standing ovation. So I plucked up my courage and approached Orion after class. It was the first time I'd ever gone up to a guy on my own. After several stuttering false starts, I finally asked him to join the occult club. Like every time before and since, he just said no.
In the past, Orion never had any interest in clubs. But if he's at the club fair now, does that mean he wants to join one this year?
The other clubs must be thinking the same thing. As Orion stalks through the gym, he's followed by a long line of students vying for his attention. Every time someone asks him to come by their clubs, though, he just walks faster.
He must be looking for something in particular.
My heart beats faster as I realize Orion is heading in this direction. More now than ever, I need to be noticed. Though my fingers are trembling even worse than before, I carry on with the ritual.
Become my heart, and fill it with your darkest power.
Orion is only a few yards away now. I have to hurry for the grand finale.
And become my soul, which I now offer up to you in sacrifice.
And in my rush to grab the last candle, I accidentally bump into the table. God damn it, cat butt. My trifold topples over, knocking down my entire display. You could hear a pin drop in the silence that follows. Or in this case, most of my food and props.
Well, I'm definitely going to be noticed now.
Face on fire, I scramble to clean up the mess. I'm so flustered, I don't realize I'm blocking the walkway. It takes a few seconds to even notice someone is standing behind me.
Whoa, you are right up in my face!
Oh, sorry!
I drop everything and scoot away. Then, thinking better of it, I rush back to shove my stuff out of the way. Behind Orion, I can hear people whispering.
What is that girl doing? Talk about awkward.
Did she spill brains on the floor? What kind of creepy club is that?
My poor zombie brain cupcakes.
Oh god, it's the occult club.
The school seriously has an occult club? No joke, I heard they're witches that worship the devil, and one of them got kicked out of school for cursing another student! What? That's not true, Layla didn't get kicked out.
You've got to be kidding me. I knew I should have gone to private school.
You're wearing a uniform, this doesn't count?
But we're not like that at all.
As the murmurs grow louder and more judgmental, I struggle for something to say. As always, the right words just won't come. In the end, I just keep my head down. That, at least, I know how to do. Seems like Orion is the only other person who hasn't said anything. Quiet as ever, he bends down and picks up a prop I'd missed.
Yorick.
Huh?
He's holding a skull.
Yorick. Yorick. Yorick.
He's holding a skull I had in my display. Not the same one we used for our Hamlet skit, but but I'm surprised he remembers it all. As I fumble for words, Orion walks over and places the skull on the table. When he glances at my ruined display, a strange expression flickers through his eyes. I take a deep breath. This is probably the only chance I'll get, so I have to try.
Would you like to join the occult club? We had a lot of fun last year. I think we'll have a lot of fun this year, too, if more people can join. So, please consider it?
No.
Well, it's not like I was expecting anything different. By now, people are starting to snicker.
Did she just seriously ask Orion Seth to join the occult club? Talk about delusional.
As if the coolest guy in school would want anything to do with that creepy club.
Again, that strange expression passes through Orion's eyes.
Something tells me he doesn't like bullying. Gee, I wonder. I think he's a nice guy. Who eats brain cupcakes? To my surprise, Orion picks up one of my zombie brain cupcakes.
I can't help but cringe when I see how ugly it looks. That poor cupcake must have been knocked over when my display fell. The frosting on the top, which is supposed to look like an open brain, has been smeared beyond recognition. And the cake itself is now squashed and misshapen. I even see part of a broken eyeball cake pop stuck to the side. What a horrible mess. Most people would just throw it in the trash. But Orion is not most people.
He's not like other boys.
Even though the cupcake is ruined and ugly, he still holds it very delicately. From the careful way he arranges his fingers on the wrapper, you'd think he was handling a precious jewel.
What's Orion doing?
Is he going to throw that away?
Ew, gross. He's definitely going to throw it away.
Om nom nom.
The whispers die out when Orion takes a bite of the cupcake.
Huh?
Orion chews quietly and then swallows. Takes another bite and then swallows again. Though his stoic expression never changes, he soon finishes the entire cupcake. As he swallows his last bite, Orion finally looks up at me. I freeze, heartbeat quickening, when our eyes meet. He stalks off before I can stutter out a reply, but I don't dare chase after him. Even with cupcake crumbs on his lips, he looks as intimidating as ever. One by one, all eyes turn from Orion to me.
Hey, can I try one of those cupcakes? Those lollipop things don't actually look too bad either.
Even the ones that fell on the floor are pretty tasty. Oh god.
Even though it's late and he can't possibly hear me, I whisper a grateful thanks to Orion Seth. In no time at all, the food at my booth is gone. Unfortunately, my club sign-up sheet is just as empty as the plates.
I was so happy that people liked my food that I let them eat even if they weren't interested in my club. And now that I'm run out of food, no one is interested at all.
Maybe I should try doing my ritual again. Though I wonder if that's actually driving away more people than attracting. Well, given how long I spent practicing, it's worth a shot. As I'm busy sketching another pentagram, a shadow falls over me.
Is that you, me petite Fräulein? You just mixed, like, three different languages in one phrase.
Huh?
A guy with Wow, look at that. A guy with dazzling golden eyes and an even brighter smile is beaming down at me. His long, silvery hair shimmers in the light as he extends a hand towards me. With his elegant airs and effortless grace, he'd easily pass for a fairy tale prince, maybe even a heavenly angel.
Gee, I wonder what that's referring to.
Feeling like a moth staring into a flame, I let him help me to my feet.
Ah, yes.
It is you, my darling Amore.
Does he know me? But I have no idea who he is. And someone this striking would be hard to forget. The guy draws my hand closer. I reflexively jerk back. That breaks any spell that he's had over me.
Sorry, but maybe you have the wrong person? I'm not sure if we've ever met.
Si, I have seen your face many times before. That is, in my dreams.
Wink wonk!
I really do think you have the wrong person. As I start to back away, he dramatically throws out his hand.
Excusez-moi, I was so taken by your charms that I forgot my manners. Allow me to introduce myself. My name is Ignace van Hexenbergen de Iseldorve, or something. I am a second-year transfer student.
Ignace van what?
He shoots me another smile, wink wonk, that shows all of his perfect white teeth.
Please, call me Ace. All my friends do.
Friends? But we're not, I don't...
And may I have the pleasure of knowing your name, my cute cochonnet?
Did you just fucking call me a pig? That's French for little pig! Excuse you? Did you think I would not understand French? I know my French.
You fucking called me a pig. This guy
is no angel at all.
I'm Catbutt.
I freeze as Ace brings my hand to his lips. Catbutt, a beautiful name for a beautiful bloom.
Just who is this guy? He's awfully forward for someone who only learned my name 2 seconds ago. On the other hand, he is the first person to come over without making a beeline for the food. Maybe I'm just desperate, but I'll give him the benefit of the doubt.
Nice to meet you, Ace. Would you, like to hear about the occult club?
My ears yearn to be caressed by your sweet voice, my love.
Okay.
Then could you let go of me first?
I like how like only one of her eyes shows in the smile. Cause like with the line it can be like, I'm gonna fucking murder you in your sleep if you don't fucking let go of me, you dumb bitch.
Finally extracting my hand from Ace's, I dig out my handwritten note cards. At least all the time I spent preparing this pitch won't go to waste.
He looks super interested.
The occult club was started by me and Layla Blair last year. We wanted a club where you could do things like telling scary campfire stories. Or watching horror movies and sharing cool creepy pastas. Even researching Wiccan rituals and paranormal sightings.
As I start talking about my favorite things, I can feel my words flowing more naturally.
Last year we did all sorts of fun activities, like volunteering at a local haunted house, going to the midnight launch for the new Silence Hell game, and studying spells for binding Beelzebub into our power. This year, well, I'm not completely sure what we'll be doing this year. So if you're interested in any of those things, or have ideas of your own, please feel free to
I trail off as I see Ace's face. He is not pleased. All of his flirty charm has evaporated, leaving his expression much darker than before. He looks as if he's bitten into a sour apple and found half a worm. I could have gone my whole life without imagining that sensation. Thank you very much.
Maybe I should have left out the part about Beelzebub. Noticing my stare, Ace clears his throat. His smile returns so quickly, I wonder if I'd only imagined it leaving.
Molto fascinante. So this, the occult club, is something you have started with your friend Lala, yeah?
Layla, actually, but yes.
I admire a cute cochonnet with so much initiative. Stop calling me a pig.
Thank you?
He looks so, like, over-the-top angelic, I'm half suspicious that he's just, like, a literal demon himself. Like, we can already tell. Come on, he's kind of a dick.
These cards, are they yours?
He points at the tarot cards I've been using for booth decorations.
I also very much admire a cute cochonnet who knows the arts of the arcana. Will you do me the honor of divining my fortune, my lovely cat butt?
When I hesitate, Ace sweeps the cards off the table. He shuffles them with an expert flourish and then offers the stack to me.
Perhaps we will discover that our destinies are intertwined.
Wink wonk! I've never done a tarot reading for anyone besides Layla before, but Ace seems interested in this part of the club, and I don't want to lose a potential recruit. Nodding at last, I accept the cards. I'll do my best. Concentrating on the deck, I draw 10 cards and lay them face down.
10 cards?! This is a newbie! And you go for a 10-card draw?
Like,
standard readings for tarot cards are like 3 cards. That would be easier on you, kiddo.
The first card should represent you, as in your personality or present state. I flip the card over, revealing a crowned man holding a wooden staff.
Royalty, naturellement. How very fitting for moi.
This is the King of Wands. He symbolizes a leader with a strong vision. Someone who never gives up. I don't mention...
Oh, the card is reversed!
I don't mention that the card is upside down, which actually alters its meaning. A reversed King of Wands doesn't just mean a strong leader. It also symbolizes someone who is manipulative and ruthless to get what they want.
The next card will show your biggest challenge. A problem you need to overcome to be happy.
I turn over the second card, which depicts a mysterious woman wearing white robes.
So it's the High Priestess.
Quelle surprise. So a lovely lady stands in my way. Alas, I do not wish to fight such a fair maiden.
I guess that's a more literal interpretation.
I'm gonna guess the High Priestess represents me.
But the High Priestess can also represent your subconscious. Maybe there's a memory or a secret you've been hiding. Some inner feeling you need to acknowledge and move on. Your true self. Believe in the heart of the cards.
Is that so? The skeleton in my closet, so to speak. Please, do continue. My breath has been sufficiently baited. I'm totally not fantasizing about slitting your throat.
Feeling uneasy, I turn over 2 more cards. The next pair of cards represents your past and future. And they are...
What, did you get the tower?
Looking down, I bite back a gasp. I quickly flip both cards back over before Ace can see them.
Are you all right, little lamb? You've become quite pale.
Sorry. I think I made a mistake. Maybe we should start over?
That at least would be easier than trying to explain both the devil and death cards without scaring him away. I do not envy you that challenge. For those of you who aren't as familiar with tarot cards, the devil and death cards are not actually that bad, but people assume that they are because, you know, they're called devil and death, but usually they represent something more like temptation or being distracted from stuff you should be doing, and death usually represents like transformation or rebirth. The really bad card you gotta watch for is the tower, which basically means your life has gone to shit. Ace just smiles knowingly, as if he's already guessed what I'm trying to hide.
What a shame. My deepest apologies.
Oh, no, it's not your fault at all. I'm still practicing my readings, so I often make mistakes.
What? No, I would not apologize for that. But rather, for this.
Huh?
Blinking, I look up, and immediately do a double take. While I was busy showing Ace the tarot cards, a small army of male students has taken down the occult club display.
Oh, fuck you. Fuck you, fuck you, fuck you!
I worked hard on that shit. My club poster, decorations, and sign-up sheet have all been moved out of sight.
Wait, what are you doing?
As soon as I bolt up, someone whisks away the chair I was sitting in, too.
Where do you want us to put the catwalk, Ace?
Right here, mon ami. This location should give everyone the best view of our club's event.
Will do, Prez!
Sorry, but I don't understand what's going on. Maybe there was a misunderstanding? I thought this spot was for my occult club booth.
Ignoring me, the boys haul in a raised platform decked out with blinking lights. My eyes widen as I realize it's one of those big fancy runways used in fashion shows.
I don't know how to pronounce that, so this is not your spot anymore. Not after you so graciously granted it to moi.
I didn't exactly mean to give you my spot. I was just distracted doing your tarot reading.
Which I now realize was probably his plan all along.
You tricked...
Oh, don't look so surprised. You see, I too have had the initiative to start my own club. And as founder and president, I will spare no expense to ensure that my club receives the best possible reception.
You already had a club?
Ace snaps his fingers. Something looks a little off with that anatomy, but that's alright. On cue, the other boys unfurl a banner that is longer than I am tall. Not a hard goal to reach, to be honest. I am not tall. One guy even throws confetti! Stepping under the banner, Ace raises his hands to the words above.
Behold! Revel in the glorious debut of the one and only Handsome Men Society.
I just want to bask in this moment.
That's hilarious!
He was actually allowed to start a club like that? Mom was right, our school standards are way too lax.
As if he's read my mind, Ace curls his lip.
Don't act as if your so-called cult club is any better. All you do is wallow in ugliness. Ugly ghosts, ugly ghouls, ugly witches.
Suck a dick, Ace.
What is the point of surrounding yourself with hideous monsters? I have a far nobler goal. The celebration and worship of one of the most important things in this world.
He strikes a dramatic pose, flipping back his hair so that it shimmers in the light. The confetti guy dutifully tosses a handful of glitter all over him.
Bellezza, beauté, beauty!
Okay.
Yes, my club will bring beauty to those that have none. Starting, of course, by bringing my beautiful self to your drab little school.
He really believes this, doesn't he?
I didn't know such narcissistic people actually existed.
Ace smiles, probably mistaking my dumbfounded stare for one of admiration.
No need to thank me, Cochonnet. I knew you were a dick from the start. It is only right that I share my splendor with the less fortunate. For to deprive the world of my God-given magnificence would be the worst possible crime. What a crime! What a beautiful cry!
I shake my head, unable to believe what I'm hearing.
But if you're a new club, how do you already have so many members?
Many more members I know than I could ever hope to find for the occult club.
All these men were inspired by my vision, of course. Isn't that right, mes amis?
The response from the other guys is lukewarm. It's less work than a sports or academic team.
I'm just here on a dare from my girlfriend.
You said there'd be free pizza at meetings? We are still getting pizza, right? Ace shoos them back into the shadows.
Pay no mind to those insignificant peasants. People with such bland faces are not even worthy of being seen, much less heard. Hee!
At any rate, rest assured that your sacrifice is not in vain.
The mission of the Handsome Men Society is paramount to the welfare of the entire student body. Thus, our premier event must be the star attraction of this entire carnivale.
He indicates the stage and lights his club has just finished setting up. The glitzy display is already attracting many curious students.
In just a few minutes, the first annual Handsome Man Society's Most Handsome Prince Pageant Contest will commence in this very spot. We have truly a monumental task ahead of us. That is, deciding who is the most beautiful and talented man in this entire school. So if you'll excuse me, dear Catbutt, while I'm sure it was a pleasure to meet me, all good things must eventually come to an end.
With that,
Ace steps onto the stage, blowing a kiss to the growing crowd. It's clear that he thinks our conversation is over. Though I can't voice the words to continue it, my hands are balling into fists. Even if he thinks his club is the best, that does not mean he can kick out my club. I can't let him, not after working so hard to get here. I've already come this far, and Layla cheered me on all the way. I can't disappoint her by giving up. I can't keep disappointing myself. No!
No one pays any attention to me. Fists tightening, I say it again.
No! Please move! This spot belongs to the occult club.
Still no one listens. Taking a deep breath, I summon all my nerve and step onto the stage next to Ace. Right under the spotlight where I can't be ignored.
Hey, what's that girl doing on a stage? Isn't that the occult club girl who made a scene with Orion? She's making trouble again? She doesn't belong up there at all.
Part of me wants to shrink back into the shadows, where no one can point at or judge me. The other part of me knows I've already done that for far too long.
Please listen to me! Even if you're fancier, and cooler, and more popular than us already, it's still not fair for you to kick out the occult club! You can't just do that!
More whispers pass through the crowd. I do my best to tune them out. I can't lose my nerve now. Unlike me, Ace never falters. As everyone stares up at us, he even smiles. He's not just comfortable with all this attention, he thrives in it.
Us, you say? But there is no us. There is only you, Nispa. You are the only person in the occult club.
That's... Well, that's...
You have already had this spot for several hours, yeah? And how many members did you recruit in that time?
I didn't...
I stiffen as Ace pats me comfortingly on the head. I will bite your hand.
My sweet lamb, I am sorry to force this question, but will another hour actually make any difference for your club? If not, perhaps it is nobler for you to give this space to someone else. Someone who will make the best possible use of it. Someone with a massive and highly appreciated event like mine.
But...
There, I knew you would understand. I knew it from the moment we first met. A kind and generous ragazza like yourself is truly pure of heart.
Please, take this complimentary voting ticket for the first annual Handsome Men Society's Most Handsome Prince Pageant Contest as a token of my deepest gratitude. Ace presses a stub of paper into my palm. Then he takes my hand and gently presses it against his heart.
Merci beaucoup, my savior angel. My heart shall never forget the happiness you have given me.
As he unleashes his most charming smile, I can hear half of the audience swooning in unison.
Oh, what a gentleman! Since when did our school have anyone that dreamy? Why can't I be the one on stage with him instead of that witch girl weirdo? I know, right? We all moved our club booths for Ace too. Witch girl is nothing special. Yeah, where does she get off making a scene and stealing Ace's attention? Wait!
But it's too late. Ace is already sauntering away, smiling and waving at the starstruck crowd. He's gone, and so is my last shred of confidence.
I'm sorry, Layla, but Ace is probably right. Even if I had another hour here, even if I had all the time in the world, I still wouldn't be able to get anyone to join the occult club. Dropping my arms and my last hopes, I exit stage left, pursued by a bear. I manage to walk all the way to the door, but once I reach the hallway, I break into a run. I don't want to think about what the other student said or how effortlessly Ace steamrolled me. I know I'm being a coward. I know it's shameful, but I just want to leave that all behind as fast as I can. Today went even worse than I thought it would. Even though I prepared so much and was so determined to succeed, it was all for nothing. A cult club still has no new members, and I'm just as pathetic as ever. No matter how much I want to be stronger, no matter how many times I try to be more confident, I'm still too scared in the end. Layla's necklace rattles against my skin as I run. I clutch it tighter and tighter until my fingers go numb. Layla wouldn't have given up. Layla wouldn't have backed down. Layla wouldn't have let anyone make a fool of her in front of the entire student body. I'm not anything like Layla. At this rate, I never will be. I'm sorry, Layla. Even now, nothing has changed. Even now, I'm still such a loser. As hard as I've tried to hold them back, tears prick my eyes. I'm so sorry I failed. Even though you trusted me. I duck into a corner praying no one passes by. Even when I was little, I hated people seeing me cry. So I'd hide in the smallest, darkest possible place I could find. A closet, the basement, under the bed. Whenever my mom caught me, I'd always make up lame excuses. My face was wet because I got caught in a rainstorm. My nose was red because I was stuck in the cold. Sometimes that was partly true, like when my classmates threw water on me to see if I would melt, or when I stood outside for hours trying to dry off before facing my mother. I always told myself not to let it get to me, that none of that would matter if only I didn't let it break me. Crying reminded me that I still broke way too easily. It's all right. It's all right. I shouldn't be getting upset. The club fair was just one way of getting new members. Even if I bomb out here, I'll just keep trying. I have to keep trying, or nothing will change at all. Fighting back more tears, I shakily get up. My hands are still clenched around Layla's necklace, and I can feel the stone digging into my palm. I let go of it to wipe my face. It's all right. It's all right. I am completely all right. Huh? I choke on what was supposed to be a deep, calming breath. To my surprise, the stone hanging from Layla's necklace has turned dark purple. Wasn't the stone blue before? Or did I misremember? Shaking my head, I start walking back the way I came. I'm probably just imagining things. Well, I'd better figure out where Ace put my club things before he throws them out. Then I can go home, take a nice hot shower, watch an episode of the Chupacabra Diaries, and eat a whole tub of my step slow as it... Oh, God. Not this sound. I'm out. Goodbye. Heartbeat sounds and medical stuff like that squick me so bad. The stone is now deep red, and it's pulsing like a heartbeat against my chest. Please don't. Maybe I'm still just imagining... That's not how imagining works.
But it feels warmer, too.
I take a few steps back. The stone instantly goes back to being cool and purple. Either all of that sleep deprivation is finally getting to me, or else there's something really weird going on. Something magical. I guess that's just wishful thinking. I've gotten my hopes up way too many times before. If this is one of Layla's elaborate pranks, I should know better than to get tricked again. Then again, maybe I'm being silly. But part of me still wants to believe. If this is some sort of sign, if this thing really is magical, God knows I could use some magic right now. Well, it's not as if I have much to lose. Taking off the necklace to look at it directly, I keep walking to the gym. The stone goes brighter with every step I take. By the time I make it back to the club fair, the necklace is blood red and throbbing. Feeling like I'm playing a game of hot and cold, I step in whichever direction makes it glow brightest. It's not easy. Now that Ace's contest is in full swing, the gym is packed with spectators. Though I can't see the stage through the crowd, the announcer is blaring out commentary over the loudspeakers.
We've had a spectacular showing so far at the first annual Handsome Men Society's Most Handsome Prince Pageant. Oh my god, why are there so many words? Did I get all that right? The fashion show, I guess. A truly handsome man can make anything look good. Case in point, here comes contestant number 12, cross-dressing as a schoolgirl. Keep rocking that mini skirt, contestant 12. And now contestant 13. Whoa, those are the smallest swim trunks I've ever seen. I don't think my eyes will ever be the same. With a roar of acclaim, the crowd surges past me.
Wow, Ace's event really is popular. I don't think I've ever seen so many people in this gym. Maybe I should come back later.
Layla's necklace pulses insistently in my hand. Biting my lip, I start wading through the crowd.
Stick to your guns for once, Catbutt. You've already come this far, haven't you?
Now it's the time for the first annual Handsome Men Society's Most Handsome Prince Pageant Contest something whatever posing competition! What pose will contestant one attempt first? And oh, it's the classic run hand through hair and look seductively over your shoulder pose. Did someone spill the glitter? Because I'm seeing a whole lot of sparkle.
Excuse me. Pardon me. Coming through, sorry.
I gulp at all the stairs as I squeeze past. Moving through this crowd is like trying to swim through molasses. I have to fight for each step, even though I don't seem to be getting anywhere.
Maybe I should have just gone home after all.
But at this point, it's too late to turn back. It'd be just as hard to get out as it would be to keep pressing forward. Last but not least, we have the first annual Handsome Men blah blah whatever romantic dialogue battle. Break out your best lines, boys. It's time to spit some sweet nothings.
I'm really sorry, but can I please get past? Yes, I do have a reason. It's, something to do with this necklace. Unless that sounds crazy, in which case it has nothing to do with the necklace at all.
And the crowd goes wild for contestant 10's
"Idiot, just noticed that I like you already, baka" line.
But will it be enough to beat contestant 4 is passionate,
"Don't look at any man but me, you're mine forever" speech.
Are you just, like, slapping people in the face as you... What is happening?
Excuse me. Sorry for stepping on your foot.
With one last push, I break through the crowd. The extra momentum makes me stumble, and I almost fall flat on my face. That would be mortifying. As I stagger up, I'm blinded by flashing lights. It takes me a second to realize I'm in front of the stage. Here, the strobe lights are so bright I have to shield my eyes. After a long and arduous selection process full of twists and turns, I don't fucking care, whatever, you knew they'd win from the start, here's your princely finalists! Finalist 1, Vincent Asher. Finalist 2, Orion Seth. Finalist 3, something whatever, I don't fucking care, call him Ace. Ace, yeah!
Out of all the guys in the entire school, or at least the ones crazy enough to enter this contest, it really came down to the last 3 guys I saw?
I back up, half hoping to slip away before they see me, but the entire crowd is pushing forward for a better look, pinning me against the stage. I have no choice but to stand and watch with everyone else. So tell us, Finalist 1, why do you want to be the first annual handsome whatever? Fuck it.
Honestly, I didn't expect to make it this far. I just missed lunch and heard there was going to be a free pizza. There is going to be free pizza, right?
A refreshingly candid reply from Finalist 1. He's more adorable than handsome, if you ask me. Don't you just want to pinch his cute baby-faced cheeks? Yep, I'm sure that didn't make him feel insecure at all. That was very kind of you. Please don't. I'll try to restrain myself. Finalist 2, same question. Why do you want to be the thing?
I don't.
Oh, well, okay. Why did you enter?
It was a mistake. I shouldn't be here.
And why did you go on stage?
To find someone.
And exactly who were you planning to find?
Oh, I see how it is.
Finalist 2 is a man of mystery. I wonder what dark and brooding thoughts are brewing. Brewing words beneath his chiseled brow. Your glare has a sound effect.
Cool!
Bye. Finalist 3, tell us why you should win this entire competition that you made yourself.
A question, excellent. My shrill voice... Yep,
that's what I was doing.
You know me, of course, as the esteemed founder and president of the Handsome Men Society, but I do not wish for my titles to win me any favors. Rather, I implore all of you to look upon my face. Is this not the face of a man très beau, a gloriously handsome man with an even more glorious vision? Ladies and gentlemen, I dream of a world full of beauty beyond measure, A world where everyone, both young and old, can experience the splendor of a gloriously handsome...
Okay, thank you, Finalist 3. Shut up.
Never fear, mon ami. I have prepared a separate speech for that occasion.
Of course you have. Without further ado, whatever, yeah, vote. Yep, that's vote. Everyone vote. Drop any voting tickets you have into the box, and we'll tally the shit.
I take cover in the corner as everyone else mobs the voting boxes. Huh, that was a close call. I don't think any of them saw me. I glance at Layla's necklace again. The stone is bright red and so hot I can barely hold it. Whatever it's sensing has to be nearby. Frowning, I move the stone in different directions to see what happens. My eyes widen when I realize what's giving off the strongest signal. No way! It's pointing to something on the stage!
The votes are in, and wow, who could have seen this coming? Everyone's tied. Wow, what's the chances of that?
Or maybe it's pointing to someone on the stage.
Hang on, folks, we're still missing... Of course we are! Yep, ticket 666. That... Yep, that... Okay, well...
Well, it's not like I can just barge onto the stage in the middle of the contest, so I might as well... Wait, why is everyone looking at me?
I like how they just all assume that that's her, 666.
Didn't Ace give a ticket to that cult club girl? She's been hiding over there instead of voting. Hey, don't hold up the contest! Huh? Oh, sorry.
Face flushing, I pull Ace's voting ticket out of my pocket. It's crumpled and covered in lint, but 666 is still visible on the front. Of course it is. Ladies and gentlemen, we found our missing ticket. Get up here, little missy. The fate of this entire competition is in your hands. Please end it all.
No, that's okay. No thanks.
The crowd throws me on the stage before I can escape. Gulping, I find myself underneath a hot spotlight, with everyone in the audience staring at me, along with the three contest finalists.
Zut alors, Cousine, also known as Holy Shit, Pig!
So our destinies were really intertwined. Ace shoots me his most dazzling smile, though I think his eyebrow is twitching. Sucks to be you! Vincent nervously looks away, and even Orion seems to be staring at the floor.
Hi again?
I stiffen as the announcer shoves the microphone into my face. Drum roll, please, we're about to find the winner. Tell us, who do you think is most handsome?
Oh!
Okay, so this is how we choose the route. I'm not choosing you, because you were a dick. I want to choose him, because he was the only one who wasn't kind of a dick to us. Oh, we can actually look at stuff. Okay. Let me actually look at your faces first. Yep. Okay. Great, so we're going to go with you, I think.
Because you're nice! Boop. Orion did help me out earlier. Voting for him is the least I can do in return. And besides, Layla was right. He's definitely got the tall, dark, and handsome thing going for him. I choose Orion.
The crowd breaks into applause. Orion finally raises his head. We have our winner. Orion Seth is officially your most handsome prince. Not even the crowd's deafening cheers can shake Orion's composure. But when our eyes meet, just for a moment, a strange expression passes over his face.
He's as hard to read as ever. I can't tell if he's happy or annoyed he won.
Congrats, bro.
Vincent grins and slaps him on the back. Ace gallantly shakes Orion's hand while plotting to murder him in his sleep.
Felicidades, mon ami. My heartfelt congratulations to a truly handsome man.
The warmth of Ace's words doesn't quite reach his eyes. I think his eyebrow twitch is getting worse, too.
Suck it, Ace!
Orion glances from the cheering crowd to Vincent and Ace, and finally back to me. Please don't hurt me.
You.
Before he can say another word, the announcer pops in between us. Congratulations, Orion. The Handsome Men Society is honored to present you with this shiny, solid gold trophy. Well, it may not be real solid gold, but hey, it's shiny. On cue, Aces Club members wheel in a pedestal covered in red velvet. On top sits a large trophy shaped more like a conservative replica of Michelangelo's David.
A splendid effigy indeed. Go on and accept it, good sir. You deserve this glorious tribute to your victory.
Orion's eyes flicker between the trophy and me. After a moment, I tentatively clear my throat.
It looks, really nice. Congratulations.
Thank you.
With that, Orion turns away. As he heads towards the trophy, the crowd cheers him on every step of the way.
Huh, I didn't actually expect him to say anything back. I wonder if I've ever heard him thank anyone else before.
As I'm mulling this over, pain suddenly stabs through my hand.
Ouch!
Hot!
I almost drop Leela's necklace. The stone has turned scalding hot and is such a blinding bright red, it hurts just as much to look at it.
Is it reacting to one of those people over there? Is it reacting to Orion? No, Orion was right here next to me, and the necklace didn't do this. It only started up when they brought in that statue.
My stomach drops once I realize what's happening.
The necklace is reacting to the trophy! Orion, stop! Don't touch it!
But it's too late. When Orion takes the trophy into his arms, he's instantly mobbed by cheering fans. I'm shoved to the back of the crowd as everyone rushes on stage.
Orion! Orion! Orion!
Oh, wait!
It's no use. I can't even see Orion through all those people. And even if I did find him, I can't possibly explain Layla's necklace without sounding crazy.
Maybe I really am crazy. Maybe that necklace doesn't mean anything at all. If I'm lucky, it's no big deal, and I'm just over...
exploding? My thoughts are interrupted by a blast of smoke, and then an ear-splitting scream.
Oh, that's right. I'm never that lucky.
Stomach twisting, I make my way through the shocked crowd. Once the smoke clears, what I see makes my blood run cold.
What's going on? It must be some kind of trick. How is that even possible? Maybe I'm not so crazy after all.
The trophy is still there, in all its shining gold splendor. Save for a few scorch marks on the floor, Orion has vanished with the smoke.
Hey! Well, that was the end of the Hocus Pocus Prince demo. If you want to see how choosing the other guys go, play it yourself. And the developers are always open to feedback, so give them your support. I'm excited to see this fully done, and I'll definitely be getting it. Thanks for watching. See you guys next time.